My name is Jerry Brito, and I'm the executive director of Coin Center. Coin Center is a public policy research and advocacy center that's focused on cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin and blockchain technologies. We're here based in DC, and you know, our job is to help policymakers, and media, and folks like you to understand more about the blockchain technology and what regulations will affect these technologies and how to think about them. Bitcoin is increasingly becoming a public policy issue, and you know, it's important to understand the technology before we consider how public policy should apply to it. So at Coin Center, if you go to coincenter.org, you'll find backgrounders on specific issues related to the technology, papers, a new survey today we released, the sentiment survey about Bitcoin. So please get in touch. Now we've heard that Bitcoin has a lot of great potential, a lot like the early internet. And a lot like the early internet, it's a protocol that's open for others to innovate on top of it. But like the early internet and the early web, it was very misunderstood at that time, and a lot like Bitcoin and blockchain technologies are misunderstood today. But we got it right once before. We got the policy right. As Fred Urson said in the keynote earlier today with Chairman Goodlatte, the Clinton administration, the Republican Congress, they worked out the right approach to those technologies. And you know, the question now is, can we get that right again with Bitcoin? So today we're going to talk about what public policy issues face Bitcoin, and how do we get it right again. And we've got a great panel with us to help us talk about this. Right next to me we have Alex Fowler. Alex is co-founder of Blockstream, which is a company that was founded last year to develop new ways to accelerate innovation in cryptocurrencies, open assets, and smart contracts. He's responsible for overseeing Blockstream's external affairs, and he has 25 years of experience in open source technologies, data security, internet policy, and user rights, and he's previously had roles with PwC, Zero Knowledge Systems, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, and the American Association for the Advancement of Science. And most recently, Alex served as Mozilla's Chief Privacy Officer and Head of Public Policy. Next to Alex is Eli Dourado. Eli is a research fellow at the Mercatus Center at George Mason University, and he is director of its technology policy program. He specializes in internet governance, intellectual property, political economy, and the economics of technology. Next to him, we have Vanessa Kargenian. Vanessa is a supervisory development associate at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, where she focuses on virtual currencies. Prior to joining the New York Fed, Vanessa was a financial analyst at Apple, where she worked on several global finance teams, as well as completing stints in London and Singapore. And then finally at the end, we have Chip Poncy, who is a co-founder of the Financial Integrity Network, and he served as the interim head of the financial crimes compliance for Mexico and Latin American region for one of the world's largest banks. And from 2002 to 2013, Chip served as the director of the Office of Strategic Policy for Terrorist Financing and Financial Crimes, and a senior advisor to the U.S. Department of Treasury. As a director of OSP from 2006 to 2013, Chip led an office of strategic policy advisors in creating policies and initiatives to combat the full spectrum of illicit finance, including money laundering, terrorist financing, WMD proliferation financing, and my favorite, kleptocracy flows. Yes. All right, so we're just gonna have just a quick Q&A conversation among us, and then we'll open it up to questions from the audience. And so first, I think I'm gonna start with Eli and ask you, Eli, to give us a brief, if possible, a pretty brief introduction or overview of the technology. You know, what is Bitcoin? What is it? Why is it important, and why is it that some say that it's similar to the internet, the early internet, the early web?
Okay, thanks, Jerry. I think this is actually a really apt analogy, the early web or the early internet and Bitcoin. One thing that happened with the early web is that people didn't understand it. So Paul Krugman has this great quote from 1998 saying that he thought the internet would have no more impact than the fax machine. Which you know clearly turned out to be false. So the question is, why didn't he understand it? What about he's not a stupid guy, right? So what is it that he didn't understand? And I think wasn't obvious to everyone about the internet is that the core innovation was separating out a protocol layer from an application layer. So there's the protocol layer that moves bits around, and then there's the application that gives those bits meaning. And with the internet, we've managed to separate those out in a way we had never really done before with telecommunications. So in previous telecommunication systems, the application and the transport layer were joined together. And so to take the analogy to Bitcoin, what we've done is all our previous financial institutions, they've bundled sort of the application, the payment system, whatever, with a sort of fiduciary role. Right, there is a bank that you trust to serve as a third party to sort of decide who owns what and keep the ledger and do all the bookkeeping. With Bitcoin, the key innovation is the blockchain technology. And what that does is it provides sort of this fiduciary role for anybody that wants it. So you can develop any potential payment or other application that needs a fiduciary. We have this technology now that uses encryption to ensure that the record is faithfully kept, and that the record of who owns what and who has what rights and how to interpret that is faithfully done. So it's just it's just separating out that fiduciary role that's going to enable, I think, the same kind of innovation that we've seen with the internet. You're going to be able to define applications sort of more ad hoc, more, you know, at the edges of the network rather than in the guts of the network as we do currently with both finance and as we did with old telecom.
So it's similar to the early internet, the early web. Looking at what we had at that point, we couldn't imagine that, you know, you would ask yourself, what is this? And some people would say, well, maybe it's email, so it's kind of like mail. And maybe it's like a newspaper, but we couldn't imagine that it's also kind of like a TV. It's also kind of like a telephone, like a video phone. It's right. All these things. So what are some consumer applications that we can imagine seeing come from the Bitcoin and blockchain technologies?
So anything that involves a fiduciary, right? So that's payments is the first one. There's also one thing that's interesting that exists already is sort of like the notary function. So you can upload into the blockchain a hash of a document, and so you can prove that document existed at a given time. Fred mentioned voting systems. That also takes on a fiduciary role, so you could do that. Identity management is one that's really interesting. You could have a permanent identity that's not necessarily tied to your real name, but nevertheless is costly to produce, and therefore could have some reputation associated with it, because you can't just create a new identity. It's not disposable in the same way that internet identities are disposable now. So a lot of interesting applications, and I think Alex has many more ideas.
So Alex, let's turn to you. You know, you were there during those days of the early web when regulators came asking a lot of similar questions that they're asking today. Grappling with these new internet technologies. How did we get it right? And what lessons can we learn from that time? And tell us about your experience during that time as well.
Yeah. I started working here in 91 for the American Association for the Advancement of Science. And I think that my experience of internet policy in those days was very different from what we're seeing today, and not just in cryptocurrencies, but in a number of technology areas where we're seeing disruption play out in different segments. And you know, I think part of that is people and values. So if we look at the sort of technical leaders that were the pioneers of the internet, right? They were largely government funded. They had a lot of credibility because they were established scientists and technologists in government labs, in academic institutions. They came to Washington, they had credibility. They understood how to partner with government to think about the different social, legal implications of the technology that they were working on. That isn't to say there weren't sort of cyber hippies and cypherpunks and others that were talking about a different type of society that this technology would usher in. But it was a very different conversation in the halls of Congress and with the administration back in those days. But I, you know, putting that aside, it's still been a slog. I mean, it has been the same issues that we started working on 25 years ago are still the same issues that we're wrestling with today. The use of encryption, anonymous communications, privacy, cybersecurity, governance of the internet. I mean, we're just in a critical phase right now with ICANN transferring into a global governance structure. So, I mean, by no means, I think, are we ready to say that we got it right. But you know, one other thing that really, I think, separates, I'll make two more points and then I'll yield the floor, as they say here. I think that the other really important point to understand about kind of the early days of the web is that it was framed in a context of commerce. So if you look at the magazine or report that was referenced earlier today, in 97 in the Clinton administration, right? It sets out a set of principles that are primarily focused on supporting commerce, right? We had the Department of Commerce really on the other side of the policy discussion in those early days about the web. Today, with Bitcoin, it's largely not commerce on the other side, it's law enforcement on the other side. It is a different conversation as a result. On top of that, if we look at kind of the people and values in, you know, who are the new voices within the cryptocurrency sector, they've been through some very challenging times over the last 25 years. We've had depressions, we've had public institutions letting us down, we've had financial institutions letting us down. We've had, you know, Snowden, we've had Target breaches, right? There's a much different climate of skepticism that, in a sense, a lot of the folks pioneering work in cryptocurrencies feel like, you know, we're going to do this on our own. We're going to find ways through technology to solve problems that government has let us down in terms of addressing. So there is a different conversation, a different set of players involved. And I guess the last comment I would make before we move on is just kind of, I think it's important to understand that Bitcoin is the internet in a sense that we have a context of technology that has allowed Bitcoin to scale and become relevant, and that is the internet. And Bitcoin shares some of the same core foundational principles, design principles, as the internet itself. It's permissionless, it's open, right? And those are core values that I really hope that more of you engaged in internet policy will recognize that, you know, we're not like this group of fringe technologists. We're actually part of the same set of players that you've been working with and representing here in Washington for the last 25 years.
So, Alex, while I appreciate your skepticism, I think that by DC standards, we got it right. In the sense that
those standards may be very low, right?
In the sense that, as you say, the Clinton administration, Republican Congress at that time chose a path that, as you say, put commerce on the other end, and as a magazine or report states, took an approach that was wait and see, only intervened when it was absolutely necessary, and as a result, we got this amazing explosion of innovation that we've seen in the internet space since then. But I'll turn to Chip now and ask, is it really the same? Because, you know, today this new technology implicates foreign asset control, and it implicates money laundering, terrorist financing, right? So what are the challenges with this technology? Is it really the same? And how can these challenges be overcome?
Thanks, Jerry. Can you guys hear me okay? Great. Well, let me just start by thanking you, Jerry, for including me. I am not an internet or new technology expert. My background, as you read, is really in combating all forms of financial crime. And it's been an interesting intersection, as you say, where, distinct from the internet, it's not commerce that's really engaging as the lead on the regulatory policies associated with new technologies and payment systems, including digital currencies. It's law enforcement. And there's an interesting, I suppose, story and discussion as to why that's the case. But I want to start by first looking at the question of comparison between the internet and Bitcoin or digital currencies. And I think starting with what there is in common between those two, there's close to universal agreement, and certainly in U.S. policy discussions, consensus that digital currencies are a good thing, and that they have a huge potential to advance our productivity, our privacy, our national security, our consumer protection interests, our prudential stability, all the things that and the interests that Alex and Eli have outlined. I don't think there's much debate about that potential. At the same time, there's a concern that the technologies associated with internet-based payment systems, including digital currencies, also introduce opportunities for abuse. And so making sure that we create an environment in which the technology can flourish and develop, but is also managed in a way that protects it from exploitation for nefarious purposes. That's really the framework in which the policy discussion is happening. And I think, distinct from the internet, it's happening in a more aggressive fashion, because unlike the internet, which is a medium, right, this is a highly regulated financial service, at a minimum. Functionally speaking, digital currencies are part of a financial system that is, unlike the press, highly regulated. We have a constitutional right to freedom of expression and freedom of speech, and we've protected that appropriately in the case of the development of the internet, and not without limits, and not without understanding how that could affect national security interests on everything from privacy to critical infrastructure. When it comes to digital currencies, the industry that digital currencies falls within is not a freedom of speech or freedom of expression industry. It's a financial services industry that's highly regulated, and for good reason. There are a number of different interests that we have collectively, socially, and having a well-regulated and transparent financial system. We've seen that on everything from illicit finance and the terrorist attacks of 9/11 to money laundering and corrupt proceeds flying around the financial system. We've seen that with prudential concerns associated with the stability of the financial system and our assets within it. At least since 2008, there's no shame in admitting that that's pretty complicated. We've seen that with consumer protection and the concerns about whether or not the privacy and depository interests and the good faith and fairness of dealing in financial services is extended to all consumers. We've seen that with respect to fair and consistent application of the tax code. So there's a lot of reasons why the financial services industry is well regulated, and those reasons aren't heavily contested. The implementation of those policies is heavily contested for good reason, because it's complicated. But I think that framework is important to understand before you get into the details of the challenges and the opportunities that Bitcoin and other digital currencies can present to advancing the interests that we have in having a well-regulated, well-managed financial system in which digital currencies can and should play an important role. So I offer that as sort of a backdrop. I know we want to get in the Q&A, and I certainly want to hear from you all. Let me give you a couple of thoughts on the regulation front that can help frame where this is going and where it's coming from. The law enforcement focus of the regulatory discussions associated with digital currency comes from, I think, an understanding that there are equally important prudential and consumer protection and tax interests associated with digital currencies at large, and Bitcoin in particular, but there's less confidence in how best to apply those concepts to an emerging technology that people are still learning about. And it's not to say that the folks that are engaged in combating illicit finance understand the technology better than others, as much as to say that the urgency associated with combating illicit finance is perhaps a bit greater, because we've seen proven abuse of digital currencies in ways that none of the proponents of digital currency would support. Nobody wants to see a black market emerge in which child exploitation or terrorist financing or corrupt dictators can get away with whatever their crimes are through a currency that we're trying to promote collectively as a productive form of currency or medium of exchange or depository instrument or commodity or however we want to take the technology as a community. And yet that's what's happened, right? That's what we've seen. And so to create protections for the currency to develop in an environment where it isn't exploited by nefarious interests, it's important to get immediately a framework in place in which those that are engaging in this technology feel that it's not being exploited and it is secure. And that protects not only the users in the currency, but the reputation of the technology from becoming a sort of a negative or nefarious technology, as opposed to a technology that can be used either for constructive or destructive purposes. So we've seen the emergence of a regulatory approach to combat illicit finance extended to digital currencies. I would offer that in taking that approach, I think the U.S. government has taken a fair balance between the urgency of putting a framework in place and at the same time not moving so aggressively that it stifles innovation. And we can have a conversation about that, but when you look around the world, it's pretty clear that there are countries that don't share the optimism or the, I think, at worst, allowance for this technology to develop that the U.S. has demonstrated. You see major economies that are moving to criminalize or severely restrict the use of digital currencies. And you see others just sitting out on the sidelines, which in an era where there's a lot of risk associated with the unknown, isn't necessarily beneficial to the emergence or continued development of the technology. So I think it's important to recognize that a regulatory approach that provides some stability, predictability, and confidence of the legitimacy of the technology is going to be important to getting it to the next level and integrating the technology into the financial system in a way that really takes it from a fringe technology into hopefully more of a mainstream opportunity.
Well, so Vanessa, I want to follow up with you on what Chip said. You know, coming from a banking regulator's perspective, you know, how do you make sure that we repeat sort of the careful approach we took with the internet to get to that framework that Chip is talking about, right? Especially in a situation where you have catch-22-like scenario where for this technology to move out of the fringe, as Chip was saying, you need banks and access to the existing financial infrastructure, but these banks and existing institutions are wary of the technology because it's in the fringe, and there's sort of a spiral there.
Sure. So before I start, I have to have the fun disclaimer that the views I express are my own and do not necessarily represent those of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York or the Federal Reserve System. So I think it's important to clarify, in order to have this kind of careful approach to policy, I think it is important to clarify kind of the business model or like use of virtual currency that we're talking about, because it has kind of many faces. The use of, if just thinking about it strictly kind of from a currency's perspective, I think is kind of one-dimensional. I mean, it is one of the aspects of it. But obviously, as we've been talking about, the kind of consensus around the more interesting aspects of virtual currency kind of lie in this underlying blockchain technology and the potential and kind of what does that necessarily mean, whether it means kind of micropayments, record keeping, kind of smart contracts. So I think, first of all, keeping that in mind in any approach to kind of policy is something that should be kind of considered. Additionally, I think it's also important to kind of level set and realize that it is an infant industry, and that most of the companies that we kind of deem more credible or the larger ones are, they're still startups, and so they have maybe 50 to 70 employees at the max. And so I think that it kind of helps. It's not like it necessarily means that we should completely ignore that from the policy front, but it is something to see that there is still kind of a timing that the industry does still need to develop. That said, I agree with Chip that I think that a company, when a company, I think then one of the elements that differentiates kind of also about virtual currency is that when a company takes control of another person's money, it does, it means that they're kind of a trusted safekeeper and that they then do kind of have to adhere to kind of BSA and so Bank Secrecy Act and anti-money laundering responsibilities. So I think the present issue facing virtual currencies that needs to be kind of worked out are ensuring that banks, BSA, AML kind of requirements can be met. And so kind of really trying to identify how do we know the counterparty on those transactions when that kind of is in counter to necessarily how the actual like transactions go through. And then I also kind of thinking through the how do you actually secure the wallets and kind of the funds aspect of it. So I think all of those kind of considering as we have these policy discussions is kind of helpful in terms of how we have a kind of a careful approach to it.
So I definitely want to get into the implications of Bitcoin and blockchain technology beyond payments and financial sort of uses. But before that, I want to give an opportunity to Alex and or Eli to comment on what Chip was saying earlier, saying that, you know, we have to understand that this is not just, it's not like the internet where it's just simply media. This is part of a highly regulated financial space, and it's different from speech. Is it completely different from speech?
I mean, it definitely has some major differences. I think it is interesting to point out the Bernstein case decision around the use of encryption and encryption source code as protected under the First Amendment. But that's a different point than the one you were making, Chip, so it's not a counterpoint to that. I think there are some important rights-related questions as we think about the technology and the ability for the community of technologists to continue to innovate. I would like to echo one point that I think I've heard everyone say, is that, you know, this is very much an area of technology in its infancy. The way that I like to think about it is that we're, you know, a company like Blockstream, we're really in a period of sponsoring clinical trials. Like, what we're trying to gather with each next iteration of technology is safety and efficacy data. To understand, you know, how this technology works, what the human interaction is, where are there potential technical bugs and other issues that need to be addressed. We definitely do not, you know, want to portray here in Washington or anywhere that the technology is at, you know, its full commercial potential at this stage.
I think that one thing that's important to recognize when you think about regulation and the various reasons that the government might want to interfere in the financial system is to evaluate sort of the trade-off that it's making. So we have payment systems because they promote human welfare, and we have financial law enforcement because financial crimes harm human welfare, and so in both cases, you know, it's the same sort of thing that you're measuring, right? Human welfare. So when a payment system comes along that changes the trade-off in terms of the amount of regulation that you're doing, right? So Bitcoin comes along, and all of a sudden, sort of being more free to transact has higher benefits than before. What that suggests to me is that the trade-off has also changed between how far we go in regulating. And so we should adjust for that fact. We don't want to apply the previous generation's financial regulation on the new technology. We have to adapt. So that means, I think, actually tolerating a little bit more abuse of the system. We have to accept that there are going to be some illicit uses. Just as, you know, in 1996, the big fear was on the internet was pornography, right? Not child porn, as somebody said. It's actually just pornography. The Communications Decency Act, you know, was very concerned about it. And before it got struck down, the decency part of it anyway got struck down. So yes, there's going to be potentially more. Bitcoin does sort of produce a little bit of discomfort for law enforcement, but I think that we're just going to have to adapt and change the trade-offs, recognize that they're changing trade-off, and that suggests to me we need less regulation in this space.
And I'll let Chip answer that maybe, and also ask Chip and Vanessa, you know, Bitcoin is a borderless technology like the internet. It's a peer-to-peer network. It's, you know, there are intermediaries that can be regulated, but anybody who wants to connect to the network can, which sort of brings up to any framework that you have has to be international in nature. How do you get that global coordination?
Thanks, Jerry, and thanks, Eli, and Alex and Vanessa. Those are all, I think, very helpful comments. Eli, your point about potentially having more tolerance for new technology like Bitcoin or digital currency, I see it a little bit differently. I think I'm like you, or as I'm hearing you, that we need to be very careful about taking an old world regulatory regime and just imposing it on the new technology. I don't think that makes sense. I agree with you on that. I don't think that's what the current U.S. policy is. When I was at Treasury, we fought pretty hard to make that clear. But I do think it's important that the concepts and the interests behind the old world or terrestrial regulation, that those concepts and that framework are applied to any competitive service provider in the field for a variety of reasons, fairness and competition being one of them, regulatory arbitrage being another, and ultimately, most importantly, the policy interest behind the regulation. Now, how that gets applied, if it's done the right way, I don't think there's a zero-sum game between the interests that law enforcement or national security may have and the interests of the consumer and freedom of operation. And we've had a live discussion on that globally, and some countries, China and Russia among them, don't agree. You know, they've criminalized it. And I think in time, it will become evident to everyone that a new technology like a Bitcoin, far from threatening our security, can significantly enhance it, because the credibility associated with the information on the blockchain is perhaps greater than the credibility of any other record keeping in the financial system. There's real value in that. It's learning how to take the concepts that are behind the sort of letter of the law that are applied in the financial system and adapt those concepts so that the interests behind them are advanced in a way that doesn't stifle the legitimate economic interest behind the technology. And how you do that is difficult, because it's a marriage of different communities that have different backgrounds and to some extent different prejudices coming into the conversation, and all understandable. But if it's going to work, then there needs to be a forum, and the events like these are important to advancing this, to putting, you know, the interest on the table and thinking through, well, this isn't a zero-sum game. If you are interested, government, law enforcement, national security, in making sure that there is access to information about the interest behind a transaction, we can give that to you, but you may be asking for A, B, and C, and we can give you D, E, and F. Is that as good as A, B, and C? In some instances, it may be better, and some it may not be as good. Let's have a conversation. It's that sort of a discussion that I think is still required. And before that can really even be held, I think an education about what it is that the technology can bring to the table, does bring to the table, and could bring to the table if adapted. And one of the things, Eli, you and I were talking about at the beginning was I being the most ignorant DC person, VC person in the room, didn't recognize this slide. I walked in here and actually thought I was in a different panel. So I don't know what this slide is, but I'm on the Bitcoin thing. I understand obviously what the blockchain is, but the point is, I'm obviously not an internet technology guy. But there are a lot of ways in which the technology can be adapted and is being adapted to support different interests, economic ones as well as other interests that could be injected. So I'm highly confident that we can emerge at a place where the proponents of regulation and the interest behind them, whether for law enforcement or consumer protection or tax or prudential, can get what they want more effectively from a Bitcoin without infringing on the fundamental interests of a Bitcoin, save one issue, which is anonymity. I do think that's a zero-sum game. I think anonymity is a zero-sum game. In my own view, and I think, you know, if I were a betting man, I'd put all the money in the world on it, that anonymity is going to lose in this debate. Anonymity is not the same as privacy. It's not the same as having controls on who has access to information. But it is about making sure that certain information is available to certain authorities on certain conditions. That, I think, can be a zero-sum game with some elements of the digital currency community. Not most of the elements that I've spoken with, but you do hear from the community from time to time sort of a zero-tolerance approach to, this is anonymous for a reason, and we don't want anyone knowing anything. And I think that is a zero-sum game. Otherwise, I feel like it's all positive-sum.
All right, so let's switch gears and get to those other uses of the technology. Unless, Alex, you want to say something? No. So, Eli, why don't you explain to us this idea that Bitcoin and the blockchain technologies can be used for more than payments or simple value transfers, right? What are the other possibilities?
So I think a number of them have been mentioned. Smart contracts are really exciting. So the idea of a smart contract is that you have sort of the execution of the contract gets done on the chain. So I set up a deal with another party, and because the network has access to sort of events that happen, I can set up a betting market or an events futures market online that where it's completely decentralized and it's executed automatically. Any other kind of contract you can think of, probably, you know, there's someone that's thought about trying to have it be executed. One that's really interesting to me is assurance contracts, or you might know this as Kickstarter. So the idea would be that, you know, sometimes we want to fund public goods through a system where we all put in money, and if we get to a certain amount, then the transfer goes through, and somebody can provide the public good. So it could be something as simple as, you know, I want to do a security audit on this open source code, and I will do it if I receive so much Bitcoin donations. And so you have a smart contract that is set up, and then people can donate, and if the payment only goes through if you reach the target goal. And then the person would be obligated to do the security audit. Some people talk about colored coins, the idea that you can use the blockchain assets on the blockchain to represent other assets. So you could have the smallest unit of a Bitcoin represent a share of stock, and then you can trade a share of stock, not just you know on an exchange, but anywhere in the world. You can transfer, you know, to your friend in Zimbabwe. You can send him a share of Apple stock, and that's, you know, that's never been possible before. One thing that's really interesting is that because this is a purely there's no third party intermediary, for the first time we're going to be able to have machines transacting on their own behalf. So you could imagine having an autonomous car that performs an Uber like service, but where you're actually paying the car instead of paying the human that owns the car. The car could transact on its own behalf. So it's just all kinds of interesting opportunities for allowing machines to interact in our economy the way humans have only been able to do before.
Right. This is part of what was announced today about the Internet of Things report is going to be looking at how do we use this technology to do that. So I want to ask Alex, is this part of what sidechains are aiming to enable?
Yeah, so finally we get to explain a little bit about the image behind us. Blockstream is a company that brings together a lot of the core technologists that are working on Bitcoin protocol. In fact, we're the first funded company that's brought these engineers together. Pretty much all of the Bitcoin code most of the Bitcoin code has been written by people who on a voluntary basis. So this has been an interesting phase in its history, and I think what we sort of signal is the professionalization of that technical and engineering effort at the protocol level. So, you know, we've all used the word protocol. Many times you've heard protocol mentioned in the conversation before lunch. If you think of protocol as just a set of technical standards, right? It's the way in which machines interoperate, and that they know that when they issue a command, that the machine on the other end is going to perform a certain function. And so Bitcoin is essentially a set of protocols that allow for a set of functions to be performed by computers. In fact, Bitcoin, the peer-to-peer network, is the largest supercomputer in the world. Today, its only application is Bitcoin, the currency. And one of the things that's been very difficult in the technical side of Bitcoin, because there is potential consumer harm, because this is currency that people buy and sell and hold, it's made innovation very slow, very conservative, because any new features, new capabilities that you would introduce that might enhance the ability to do new kinds of things, as Eli was mentioning, could also introduce security vulnerabilities, could introduce problems that put at risk the entire currency supported by the Bitcoin blockchain. So it's been a very difficult challenge for the community to think about the pace of innovation for Bitcoin. And as a result, we've seen hundreds of what are called altcoins, alternative forms of digital currency, that have been created. And many of those altcoins are looking at new kinds of smart properties or smart contract capabilities, other kinds of sizes in the capabilities and features supported by the blockchain. And so, in a sense, what Blockstream is trying to do with its sidechain technology, which I'll summarize as quickly as I can, is meant to kind of bring that innovation back into Bitcoin itself, where we can start to create interoperable chains where you have different use-specific blockchains that are still able to use Bitcoin as the underlying currency. So what we end up with is, you know, we jokingly around the, you know, water cooler talk about it as, you know, innovation without speculation, right? So instead of spinning up a new currency and trying to create excitement about the currency, we're spinning up new innovation itself about what is possible with blockchain and letting that be essentially the feature of what we're trying to create.
So you're piggybacking on a network effect that Bitcoin has already generated.
Exactly. And we're showing that we're creating more value for the ecosystem overall to drive incentives, to drive new participants and new mainstream applications. But it's, you know, early days. So anyway, the way that this is described is, if you think about TCP/IP, right? So that's the underlying protocol by which computers on the web are able to perform the functions of content distribution, information sharing, and so forth. And so if you imagine a world where Amazon required you to download their particular set of protocols in order to buy books, and then when you go to Netflix, you had to download a whole different set of technical capabilities in order to take advantage of the services that Netflix offers, right? And you expand this out to every type of major business online, and you realize that's not a scalable system with a network effect that is going to work. And in fact, if that's how the internet had evolved, we wouldn't be having this conversation today. We'd be in a much different world. And similarly, we're trying to apply that same rationale to Bitcoin itself by creating interoperable protocols that allow use-specific side chains, as we call them, to interoperate with the main Bitcoin blockchain. So in this example here, we have a side chain. It can support smart property. It can support micropayments. We also have the ability to add a beta release. So in fact, the main blockchain itself could, let's say, increase the size of blocks. They could test it on a beta release side chain. When it's ready for main for production, it can be moved over. And then the real sort of science of the company is around this pegging mechanism that allows you to peg coins from the main blockchain and move them into a sidechain to power it or to buy a different kind of asset or a derivative or something like that that's offered in a different sidechain. So we published our white paper last year, and we're in the process of bringing out the first generations of sidechain technology for the community to start to build on.
So I want to get to Q&A, but before we do, I just want to ask Vanessa, you know, something I often hear from regulators is real concern that technology, and we've been hearing about paying the Uber car itself rather than the driver, where there is no driver, technology outpaces the ability of regulators to keep up. Is that something that should be a concern?
I think in any way, we have to wait and see and kind of evolve, right? And so technology, you're always, there's something that's always new, there's something that's always that's always innovative, and whether that, and so as regulators you just have to adapt to that, and whether we're sometimes too slow at that or not isn't the case, but I think it's just this is something we just have to kind of see how the space evolves and just kind of go from there. That's the best we can do.
All right, so let's open up to Q&A. Any questions from the audience? All right, right here.
So I was curious, sort of building on Chip's point about, I guess, the arm wrestling match over anonymity, if you've seen, or I guess what your read is on the Silk Road trial in that context, we're seeing a lot of observers use properties of Bitcoin that seemed at least semi-anonymous and have become very useful for prosecutors trying to connect over to a specific identity. I'm curious if you see that as how you score that in terms of the fight over whether Bitcoin will ultimately remain anonymous.
Yeah, it's a great question, and I would immediately separate policy interests and capabilities that are internet-based and information sharing and sort of a freedom of speech and press angle from what is a financial service. And obviously there are technologies that are applicable to both, and digital currencies and other forms of payment systems can be internet-based. But I say that because the debate over anonymity with respect to financial services, I think, is a lost cause for those proponents of anonymity. The debate over anonymity with respect to messaging on the internet, I believe the U.S. is firmly on the other side of that, to say that on the one hand, you do want to have responsible sort of actors that are to some extent accountable for what is said, but you also, we have a fierce protection to be able to say what you want and disclose or not disclose. And there are instances in which we can all understand that becomes really important, is fundamental to who we are. And when you look at the debate about you know, what's happened, a good example is with Iran and the use of the internet to basically share information about dissidents in that country trying to effectively protest a regime of repression. We've always felt that way as a country. We felt that way at our birth, right? So the anonymity piece of this has to be, I think, carefully labeled as to what we're talking about. If we're talking about freedom of speech, it's one thing. If we're talking about a financial service, it's another. With respect to Silk Road, I think there, and I haven't kept up on the details of the trial, the prosecution, I'm familiar with the underlying facts, it's clear that the users of Bitcoin in that space were ones that were attracted to what they perceived and was, in fact, to some extent, an anonymous opportunity to transact in illegal activity, right? So, but for the perceived and to some extent actual anonymity of Silk Road, they didn't have a business, right? So that's the fundamental, I think, policy lesson, that if you build a forum in which anonymity is perceived, and whether or not it's actual is a separate question, you are going to attract people who want to be anonymous. And not everybody who wants to be anonymous is a bad guy, but in the financial services space, there's a lot of risk with anonymity, there's a lot of risk with transparency, and clearly with respect to illegal activity, transparency is the enemy, right? So I suppose in hindsight, everyone could say, well, yeah, if you're going to build, you know, a dark market of financial services on the internet, then if you turn the lights on and you see that there's a lot of bad guys, who's going to be surprised? But that's kind of the point, right? So in the context of Silk Road, you know, the takeaways for me are that it's a proof of concept that anonymous conduits, pathways, allowances, vulnerabilities in the financial system will invite abuse. It will invite abuse. It's a validation of the premise of financial transparency in the financial system, in part to guard against illicit activity like that, in part to guard against the other financial interests I outlined earlier. But it's also a caution sign over what is a highly regulated industry of financial services and what is a platform of the internet in which anonymity, in some instances, is our friend and certainly is not the enemy as a messaging medium, except when it's used to undermine regulation in a highly regulated industry. So I think those are take-homes that may be self-evident to folks in retrospect, but I don't think we're clear at the outset, and I think even now tend to get blurred.
Any other comments on anonymity?
I'm not so sure it's as cut and dry as Chip makes it. I think anonymity is likely to win because I think it's just inevitable. It's very difficult to separate anonymity in speech from anonymity in financial transactions. In a digital currency world, spending money is the same as transmitting information. So as long as we continue to allow encryption, which, you know, as Alex mentioned, there is a somewhat of a First Amendment case for. I would also argue possibly a Second Amendment case because it's munition, possibly Fourth Amendment, possibly Fifth Amendment, possibly Ninth Amendment, possibly 14th Amendment. I've heard all of these cases made. If we're allowing encryption and we're allowing unfettered anonymous communication, I don't see how you stop anonymous payments. And I think that this is just one of those areas where the trade-offs have changed socially, and I think we should start to think about, you know, how we could live with that.
Yeah. Thanks, Eli. And again, I have to caveat everything I say with, I'm the most ignorant person in the room on a lot of this stuff. But it was also clear that in the regulatory discussions that have happened and that have led to the current framework in which digital currencies and other emerging payment technologies are regulated as money transmitters under effectively AML regulations, that there continues to be an open question over what happens within the DC world, right, digital currency world, because the sort of premise of the regulatory approach taken to date is that the gateways, the exchangers, when you go in and out of real currency to digital is where we will see you and where we will demand transparency. So, you know, that's a factual statement. And what happens within the DC world is kind of like a big tumbling washing machine, and our sort of transparency into that is pretty limited. And that's a deliberate decision not to get into that level of detail until we better understand. And I keep saying we. When you work for the government for 10 years, it's always we. And I should do the Vanessa thing. I do not speak for the Treasury Department and the government. I've been out for a year and a half, and I don't think they'd have me back in any event with all my free speech outside of government. But I think everyone who's followed the debate recognizes that there's a real caution to defining the internal transaction space until there's a better understanding of some of the issues that you've raised. I certainly am not one that has an opinion on it because I don't know enough about it. I do know that the decision and the requirements apply when you go from terrestrial to virtual. And it was done that way because we felt the government felt comfortable enough at that point that it understood that pathway to be able to apply that fairly, uniformly, consistently, but not to go further. And that's a frontier that hasn't been decided yet. And those sorts of issues that you're raising are ones that I'm sure will be relevant to how or whether that the next step proceeds.
Yeah, I have to say, I think both Eli and Chip are right. That I think Eli is right that there's going to be some amount of anonymity that really is not going to, you're not going to be able to prevent it. And so then the question for regulators, for law enforcement, is how can they get the help of intermediaries that want to comply and make sure that those intermediaries account for 98-99% of all transactions, and then really address that remaining bit as best as they can. Other questions right here?
No, I just want to follow up. I'm sure that long since gone beyond sort of the end-to-end world in terms of that establishing more of a traffic than the actual human interaction. And so just as we went, you know, from voice to data, we're now into M2M, and that's going to just accelerate. So I don't think it's impossible or I easily see a situation where the car has an account itself to fill up the gasoline to, and it becomes an autonomous. And one of the things, the challenges for Treasury, NSA, et cetera, is as they do the DPAC, well, first they strip off, you know, go after your encryption, and then they do the DPAC and inspect, and they go, this end-to-end communication just...
Is there a question?
So much background, my question
yeah.
is, I agree that I think at the end of the day, it's really going to be very much an anonymous situation to the point to where you're really not even going to know, even now, you know, there are prompts that help determine whether or not you are actually a human being making the engagement as opposed to a machine interaction, right? That little encrypted thing you've got to go through. It gives you some sort of a GUI that you've got to transpose. Anyway, that's going to be a big problem. Because that is going to, I can see that easily.
All right, any other questions? I think, I see one here.
Do you think there's a role in regulating the infrastructure of Bitcoin, the protocols, or the...
Alex?
No. Hands off the protocol. Actually, you know, we do have a pretty significant disconnect in the policy conversation right now. I don't know many protocol level developers that have come to Washington and spent any time with either regulators or policymakers. That was a big difference. I mean, that is a big difference from what we had 25 years ago at the beginning of the web. And I think we need to reestablish that dialogue. I think a lot of these questions about regulation are primarily happening at the business level. And they are intermediaries, so it's a natural fit in terms of where we are with a lot of the large mainstream uses of Bitcoin right now. But you know, the vision is that those intermediaries go away, and this really is a decentralized, distributed peer-to-peer network. And so my fear is that if we don't start that dialogue now, the developers are going to end up being the subject of litigation and regulatory action in the absence of any other player that the government can turn to. And I mean, we've seen in copyright, we've got the, every year a few obligatory cases of music sharers, kind of hauled out for all to see for their, illegal activity. I think in the same way we could foresee similar things with super users or developers in cryptocurrencies being the subject of this type of government action. So I really think it's important that we start the dialogue, we get the technologists here, that we're actually talking about what the protocol enables, what it doesn't, where the limitations are, and start thinking a lot more seriously about not necessarily compromise, but just understanding ahead of the time that this is in production at commercial grade, what some of the implications are.
And just to be clear, you're saying no to regulation of the protocol, but when you have anti-money laundering, KYC, Bank Secrecy Act type regulations of intermediaries that sit atop of the protocol, that's happening today.
Yeah. I mean, there's a great example that I'd like to point to in the privacy area where, it's still required by law that government websites have P3P compact policies, but there isn't a single browser on the market today that actually supports P3P anymore. So, there's a technical standard level regulatory requirement that the government spends time implementing and testing across all its sites, but has actually no meaning in terms of enhancing a citizen's understanding of what that site does with their personal information. So, I think there are the protocol today is not going to be the protocol in 3 months, in a year, in 10 years. So, I think it's not realistic that regulation is going to be able to match, all the different technical proposals that are in discussion.
All right, I think we have time for one more question over here at the end.
Yeah, my name is John Meyer, I'm a writer at I'm wondering if you have any sense of the timeline for some of the applications besides currency, if that sort of matches, if more people start to use Bitcoin, if that increases the odds of those applications growing faster.
So some applications are already out. As Alex said, a lot of it's been being done with altcoins right now, not with actually Bitcoin. So there's something called Namecoin that I'm a fan of that lets you sort of have decentralized blockchain-based domain name systems. So instead of registering alex.com, Alex could register alex.bit, and that URL would only be available if you had a computer configured to read that, but that's an application that's already out. Notary services, proof of existence is already out. I think Alex, though, you might have other thoughts on that.
I think those are kind of the main ones. You're seeing projects launching that are focusing on smart contracts and scripting language to enable that. You probably know others as well in your membership.
I think that there are any number of applications that already exist today, but some of the ones that I think consumers are going to be using more widely, it's going to be a while. And I can't tell you what that while is. It's going to be, a year, 2 years. To me, I see the whole Bitcoin ecosystem as a 5 to 10 year project. If you think about where we are now in comparison to the early web, we're at the stage where Mark Andreessen is introducing Mosaic, right, which is the first web browser. right? And so we're we're 4 years out from Google existing. We're 10 years out from Facebook existing. And we're in that spot. All right, so with that, I think we're out of time. I want to thank the panel. And I want to tell you that Chip said something very important, which is that we need a place that's a forum to have education on this topic and to be a forum for these kind of conversations to happen where all sides can come together. And I think that's what Coin Center is striving to be. And I have to correct Alex, who said that no product, as far as he knows, no protocol level developers have come to DC and talked to folks. I want to say that Jeff Garzik, one of the five core developers of the Bitcoin protocol, who's on our board of directors, has come to DC, and we've made sure he's had good conversations. So that's what Coin Center is trying to do.
We got to bring the rest.
Yes. Thanks to our panel, and thanks to all you.